At this pivotal time in humanity's evolution, we are beginning to remember our organic technology. A technology, when used correctly, can create an experience that the majority of the people the world over want to live. It is time to use this technology consciously for our own benefit and healing, and no longer unconsciously for our own demise. We are divine creators, creating both our own personal experience and our collective experience moment to moment. We invite you to join us as we reawaken this technology through experiment and experience our power to create and manifest. Become part of the 3%.
Welcome, 3%ers. This is Lisa Harrison, and this is this week's Collective Imagination Show. And we have Brian Kelly with us.
Hello.
Hello.
Good to be here. Hello. Good to be here, as usual. I'm a little bit feisty today, and gosh, we never really know what we're going to get ourselves into on these calls, so I'm just excited to see what comes up. Woohoo!
Good to see you're in fine form as usual. How are you, Bob?
I'm doing great. Welcome, everyone, to the show. Glad to be here. And as we know, Brian is our tickle ninja.
Oh, God, I'm never going to live that one day.
No, you're not.
Okay, Chris.
Get it together, Lisa.
I know, I'm trying. Chris Hale.
Morning, everybody. It's an absolutely beautiful day here, and I slept well. Everything looks good, feels good. Hope you're good, too.
Isn't it amazing what a good sleep can do?
It is, actually. Quite extraordinary. I should do it more often.
Yes, you should. You really need to.
I do.
Okay, guys, we're going to start off with some just housekeeping, some announcements, basically, and then we'll get into whatever it is we're going to discuss today. The first one would be a quick update on yesterday's announcements in regards to Daryl and Scott and Uwe. So I'll hand it over to you, Chris.
Surely. Daryl's interview is up on the OPPT site in the blog section. Please go and have a listen to it and keep yourself appraised. We will be organising an email flash mob, and it will either be on the OPPT site or via the one that... was announced yesterday. In fact, may do both. The Absolute Data website.
Absolute Data Exchange.
Thank you. Absolute Data Exchange, which is an automated system for actually doing exactly what we need to do. So we need to actually make sure we use that facility. So look out for notices about that. The situation with Uwe and his fight against the bank for them to force them to justify what it is that they're actually doing when they lend money. This is the court case that went from being a series of letters between him and the bank, jumped straight to the High Court of Western Australia in front of the Chief Justice of Western Australia. So they are nervous. They are looking at engaging a barrister to assist with this one because this is pretty much a straight legal challenge to what they're doing. There is a donate button on the website Free Speech Australia. We are going to be starting up a campaign to try and pull together some extra funding to make sure this all happens as it should because it could lead to a real revelation. And they need all the support they can get. So if you can put a couple of dollars into their account, that would be absolutely fantastic. And we'll be bringing that up again next week during the first episode of the One People Show.
Yes. Is that it for you, an announcement?
Just noting that there's an update from Julian on the OPPT website as well, for those who like to follow Julian Wells' work.
Okay, great. Yeah, always
That's
interesting
it.
To have a listen.
It is. So just those websites, Free Speech Australia, for the... action that Scott and Uwe are taking. Have a look at the videos. They're great. They're really, really good. Amongst the best I've seen on explaining stuff. And Daryl's interview on OPPT. And that's it.
Okay. Now, Facebook. We, as announced yesterday, the opt-in show is moving over to the 5D Media Network. and it will be called The One People Show, The One People Radio, or TOPS. Sounds good, doesn't it? It's TOPS.
It is.
And we have a corresponding Facebook page. So it's facebook.com/5D Media Network. And I would appreciate it if you would all go and like that page. That's where all the upcoming shows will be notified. That's where the discussions will move to. Not sure what's happening with the optin.com Facebook page at this point. But also for TCI. So all TCI and opt-in, former opt-in news will now be shared on that new 5D Media Facebook page. So please go over there and like that one. And there's also a fun little bit of flash mobbing. There is an image. Barbara's probably going to have to help me with this one, where they can find it. Experience a cool new perspective. You'll see it as a post. And it's an image of a monk walking along a street looking a little different. And it's a great image of a new perspective. And if you could share that, that would be lovely. Get the ball rolling. I think I've said everything I need to say about that at the moment. I know Barbara will slap me about if I have left anything out. And she does so beautifully. What else? Was that all for announcements? Okay, I think so. One of the things that have come up, well, actually time and time again since the former OPPT came out, is the idea of enforcement. And some of you, those of you who follow Brian's blog, will have noticed that he put up a post which was a conversation and an explanation from Heather about the difference between enforcement and enforcement. And it's a really interesting path to go down, because there's a book, which I'm sure I've mentioned on this show many times, called Power Versus Force, that I've had for about 10 years. And we've brought it up in terms of the... We've brought it up on this show in regards to the idea of, you know, those who use enforcement are those who don't know that they have true power within. And I guess that's what we're talking about today, is the idea of power versus force, power being true enforcement. And when you're not in tune with that, you use force and enforcement. And what we have been seeing, whether we're consciously aware of it or not, or recognizing it for what it is or not, is enforcement, true power, true enforcement by the one people with all of their being and doing. And it's subtle, because it's not what we're used to. You know, we're used to enforcement with a gun in your face, you know, with consequences, with fines, with no choices. And now, we are having this discussion on the fly. We haven't pre-discussed this. This is, you know, we're just putting it out there, and I don't even know where this conversation is going to go. But it feels very, very important right now for us to start to recognize enforcement when we see it and feel it. Because it's not, I don't see this change that we're going through happening through enforcement. You know, if you listen to Drake and a lot of others over the last year or so, that it's through enforcement, guns in faces and arrests and you know, a bit of chaos, that they see as being the way the world's going to change. And I'm not getting that. I don't see that. I see, you know, young guys walking into banks and talking to the bank managers and having the bank managers apparently put up the enforcement order in their tea room so everybody can read it. This is the sort of stuff that is enforcement, you know. So what do you, firstly, I'm gonna stop talking because I feel like I'm rambling now.
Well, it's, to me, it's all related to what we're moving into. It's the transformation that we're all moving into. We're becoming more responsible for every aspect of our lives. Each and every one of us are starting to step into that and embracing that responsibility because we understand that that is the only way that we can truly have our freedom. And the idea of enforcement versus enforcement, it's like the way I look at consequence versus punishment. And Neil Donald Walsh explains this brilliantly. You know, when you, punishment is a artificially created outcome. And what do you learn from punishment? Well, if you learn anything, you usually learn how to be more careful. It doesn't necessarily change your attitude about what you're doing. In other words, if somebody punished me for smoking marijuana, it's not going to change my view about smoking. Okay?
It's only going to change your view about getting caught smoking.
You're right. It will teach me to be more careful. Whereas consequence, which is a naturally occurring outcome, when I suffer consequence, then I immediately change my ideas because when I suffer consequence, then I know I have no one to blame but myself. I have to make the change. And so this is the whole idea, you know, enforcement wants to punish, but enforcement allows the natural consequence, allows it to naturally, and in that allowance, there's a transformation of the other. There is a transformation that happens internally within them. And this is the reason why you're seeing branch managers doing what they're doing, you know, and actual law enforcement agencies and people who were formerly perpetuating a lot of the enforcement against people, you know, like in Daryl's case, refusing to do the job because they are now experiencing the enforcement and they're transforming. And this is something that naturally happens. This is, we're watching the 100th monkey effect in front of us.
I'd like to put another idea into the mix, and it goes back to the concept of the yin and the yang, the male and the female. And when you look at the system that we're exiting at the moment, it's very much male-oriented, male-dominated, going into something which is more balanced. I would hope it wouldn't swing completely the other way. What we're after is balance. However, we're out of balance at the moment. We're pushed way towards the male and aggressive side. And if you look at the difference between enforcement and enforcement is dad giving you a smack up the side of the head for talking back to him. Mum is patiently explaining, lovingly explaining, that what you did was probably counter to a maintaining a good relationship and bringing you to an understanding so that you change yourself internally rather than the other, which just gives you a sore ear and a desire not to get not to put yourself in that position again. There's learning in both of them, but it's not the same.
Well, yeah, you end up learning. Well, you end up behaving based on consequences. I won't do that because I'll get caught, or I won't do that because I'll get a smack across the ear, as opposed to that doesn't feel like the right thing to do.
Exactly. You learn. The learning is different. You know, one's a learning one's an empathic learning, and the other is a reactionary learning. The empathic learning is when you grow on the inside and make a decision based on you know, knowledge, experience, positivity. The other is recoiling from a negative experience. You know, one's based on a fear response, the other's based on a love response. It's probably the simplest way to put it.
Oh, nice way to put it. Yeah, nice. Brian, do you want to read what you posted?
Which I just got back. Which post
are you what do you mean you just got back? Where have you been?
I put BRB in the chat room. You see that gentleman message to you over there? Okay, what do you want me to read?
the post you put up in regards enforcement versus enforcement.
Oh, yeah, I can read that. Okay, here it is. Shall we read you the whole thing? Just kind of jam through it?
Whichever you like.
Okay. I think it's all pretty relative. Heather starts out, enforcement. It's going to be hard to differentiate between the enforcement and the enforcement, but I'll do my best. Training and programming was excellently done, and I give absolute gratitude for the doing of every embodiment so that these experiences are in eternal essence of consciousness. Done so that it is experienced and informed choices can be done in all moments of now after the finale. What is enforcement with an E? That is perhaps the best place to start, to know what each considers enforcement. Enforce or enforce. I do begin the decode of the illusion of enforcement to reconcile the programming training of the illusion of preset conditions and expectation, also known as enforcement, so that all may know absolute truth what is and be visible all along and is done. Enforcement with an I. Enforcement has been happening all along, just not the way any embodiment expected it because it was hidden by design for the experience. Many do not see enforcement because what is happening is enforcement with an I, but they sense enforcement more and more each moment of now. All embodiments in Eternal Essence's universe then do know what they saw and experienced and heard all these recent moments was in absolute truth enforcement with an I, and that is that it was visible every moment. Because many embodiments were taught the former system's enforcement and how it is to be seen, experienced, and known, many embodiments were previously unable to know, see, or sense enforcement. However, those at the top of those former systems who controlled those former systems know enforcement and know that enforcement is happening, and that all the enforcement has been and is visible all this time. That is what makes them nervous. That all do know, see, and consciously do enforcement. That is what they fear. And I do put that enforcement into absolute context now in these final moments of the finale for all to know, see, and experience. If they choose by their free will to do, with absolute love, gratitude, and peace. Just because one cannot visualize absolute enforcement or comprehend the absolute context of what is visibly happening does not mean it does not exist or is not happening. The data is here. When has something else existed and been enforced that no one could see or sense? And when they could finally see, if they still could not see it, and when they could see it, they could not comprehend it or know the machinations of it, but they knew they were experiencing it. How about we use something familiar to many? The former slavery systems were existing and enforced with an E before anyone saw them visibly or sensed them. Even when sensed, they were not seen. And when seen, they were not known in absolute context. And every moment of existence and enforcement, those who were in control paid all energy to make them not visible, not sensed, not known, yet enforced. They knew embodiments were awakening when the former systems could be sensed. They knew they were sensed by the thoughts, words, and actions of the embodiments. They also knew that sensing could lead to seeing and that seeing can evolve to knowing. And that knowing can evolve to doing. Well, what has been and is happening now? Being and doing are absolute empowerment. That is part of enforcement with an I. Thanks to the doing of embodiments like you and many, many others, since the experiment experience began, all that is be made visible to see, know, and then to experience as chosen by free will choice. I thank you for confirming the current vulnerabilities and okay, this is that. So the rest isn't relevant, but I know that's hard to understand because I suggest going and reading it because a lot of those enforcements are spelled with E's and a lot of them are spelled with I's, but. I mean, the most – I think that for me, the most – like when it really clicked was the part where she explains how the slavery systems were put into place by, you know, the Illuminati or the powers that were, whatever you want to call them, without anybody sensing it or knowing it or understanding it. It was like it was a carpet that was put underneath us without anybody really knowing what was going on. And for that's the point where everybody gets that we use this word awakening. Are people awake to this information? And it's the waking up that allows people to see the carpet has been put under us. And now we essentially are pulling the carpet out from underneath the whole system, which is the enforcement with an I. And I believe ultimately that will, you know, for me personally, I believe it will, there will be some level of enforcement with an E, but the enforcement with the I to me is so much more powerful because it's what has been happening with blunt force. I think that's maybe a bad terminology to use, but with, let's say, great perseverance for the last 5 or 6 months with everything that we've been doing now being brought out into the light. You know, I know Heather mentions the term, the finale in there quite a bit. She's been talking about it quite a bit publicly and saying that May is definitely energetically a very big month. And I think that as these days and these weeks progress, the enforcement with an I it's like a wildfire that's reverberating out of the consciousness of all of those awakened to get to the point where there's that effect of the 100th monkey, in which case, boom, we're at that tipping point. And I feel like Sophia Love described it best in a post that she put out today about life being just a ride. And we're getting to that point where we're on the roller coaster. The roller coaster is chinking its way up that hill. And you get to the point where that thing, all of a sudden, it's going to go over that first threshold, and then gravity and the weight of the cart is going to take that thing into this loop-de-loo, twirly spin, absolute crazy ride of excitement. And it's time to buckle our seatbelts because there is absolutely nothing to fear. It's just a ride. So going into it with a certain level of love and excitement as opposed to fear that there's going to be some chaos or unknown variables that are going to come and play a problem. That's, for me, that's what this whole idea of enforcement as opposed to enforcement. God, that's confusing. Sorry, everybody. I have no idea what we're talking about.
This is where we get back to the collective imagination.
I'll just throw in one more thing to that. That whole episode with Daryl being arrested last week, that was an enforcement by the system, okay? But through the entire process, Daryl was enforcing because all the way through he was educating them. He was talking to the police when they came to his house. He was talking to the solicitors when he got to the jail. He was talking to the inmates when he got to jail. That was enforcement. He was educating, which is an act of giving. Okay, enforcement is an act of taking, you know, take someone's freedom, take their dignity. And I think the energies of the period of time we've come out of supported enforcement, and the energies of the period we're going into support enforcement. And this is why people are waking up to it. And that young man that walked into the bank with the foreclosure flyer, he was enforcing. He wasn't going in there to tell anyone that, you know, they were under arrest and he was going to change, he was going to wreck their world. He was there to educate.
Yeah, I'm going to post that video in the chat room right now. Probably a lot of people that are listening that are in the chat and in the chat room have already seen it. It's Chase. He goes by the handle Chase Face Benny on Facebook, and he's somewhat of a celebrity right now because he put out this amazing video today talking directly into the camera about his story going into the bank, asking to speak to the bank manager, saying that he had a delivery for the bank manager. Bank manager came over. He delivered the flyer. She read it. She had never heard about it before. And at that level, I guess it's very common because, you know, the way that banks are set up, there's many levels of hierarchy above a branch manager. So there's no surprise they have not heard about it. But she was surprised. She treated him with respect. And she said, well, what should I do with this? I think she actually asked him. And she said, you know what I could do is I'll put it up in the break room and then the employees can read it. So That, to me, is absolutely hilarious. And I believe he actually was out doing the exact same thing today and getting a very similar response. So it goes a long way when you go in and you really stay true to the integrity of the courtesy part of the courtesy notice. I think you accomplish a lot more that way.
Yep, that's really, really, really the most key thing if you're going through that process. And yesterday it was Sovereign who was telling us about a similar exchange but at a much higher level in a bank, and I just wonder whether we shouldn't be just wandering into as many local branches as we can and doing a bit of enforcing.
Well, I actually do want to have a discussion with the people behind the opt-in website. What I'd like to do is record a bit of role-playing between us. You know, someone playing the bank manager, someone playing the person walking in to do the educating, and let's just role-play it and come up with as many different responses as we can, so people can do a bit of practicing and put together a good document package that you can walk in there with. And we can be doing that all over the world, walking into different banks and just educating. And that's my plan. So I'd like to get that up by next week. So BZ and Holly, if you're listening, which I'm sure you are, that's the plan. Now, getting back to what Brian was saying earlier and Bob, is, I mean, everything is energy. And the collective imagination is that pool of imagination from each of us individually that becomes a magnetic ball of energy in itself, which has to go somewhere. It has to create. That's what it does. That's all it does. So that's what I see enforcement as I just see this huge ball of energy of all of our being and doing, all of our intent, all of our creativity is just fueling it and building it. And the repercussions of that just spreading like a virus, like a beautiful virus. And the enforcement flows as a result, because we just start to change. Everything starts to change.
Well, that's exactly the scenario that Julian Wells was describing about a week and a half ago when he was looking at the energy of the one people. That was almost exactly. I don't know whether you were aware of it, but you're pretty much using the exact words that he was using when he looked at the energy that this whole meme is creating.
No, I haven't listened to it yet. Okay.
Well, you're tuned into it because you'll be startled when you hear what he actually said. But it's the energy he's seeing around the concept of the one people is the most energetically active thing that he's ever seen. And it was like it was spreading like, you know, a virus. And it would pretty much leap to any other individual, and they might get a shock, or they might get a bit of a blast, or they might find it a really positive thing. But they'd get a message, and he described it as being incredibly flexible from that point of view, is that it'll actually adapt. These are his words. So
beware of the love virus. It is incredibly contagious.
The love
yes.
virus.
that's
there's no cure.
Nope.
It's terminal.
Exactly. Well, see, the thing is, once have you known anyone ever to be really woken up and to go back to sleep again? It just doesn't happen. You know, you can't go back there. Same thing.
You can't unknow what you know. It
just, if you could, would you want to?
Absolutely not. Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes there are moments where you think, "Oh, life was so much easier when I was completely ignorant and asleep."
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But no, you don't.
I vote no to that. Those moments pass.
They do very quickly, but you know, I can't say they haven't
done. But energetically, you can see. I mean, everything's shifted so much since Christmas. Energetically, it's just not that we're just not in the same realm. We're not in the same reality, from my perspective. And the thing is that most people are to some extent or another lifting in consciousness, and you know, hence the acceleration, you know, of the energy of the one people.
Mm. I was doing a Reiki session, a distance Reiki session on a client late last week, And I got this visual. I get pretty powerful visuals when I do these sessions. And I got this visual. Sometimes I don't know what they mean, but it was my client was walking. It was like I was looking at a wall. There was two doors on the wall, and she walked out of one with like lightning speed, and like without even thinking a second thought, walked directly into another door that was adjacent on the exact same wall. And the door that she walked out of was a red door, and the door that she walked into was a blue door. And when I told her, I said, you know, I'll share with you what I saw. That you might know what it means better than me. I said, you know, you walked out of this room like you've been there, done that. You were over it, and you knew exactly where this other door was before you walked into it. So you were so ready to go there that you just, boom, it was like in and out. And she's like, and you think that I would have picked up on the Matrix idea of the blue pill. But I didn't, you know. I didn't. She's like, oh yeah, it's like getting rid of the red, being sick of the red, like this damn red pill, and then popping that blue pill down like you've been waiting all your life for it. So I think that humanity is gearing up to take one giant blue pill, in my opinion. Get ready.
Okay.
I'm ready.
I'm just going to put a link up here to your blog with the article from Heather. So it's in there, in the chat room, people. But it's just Brian Kelly's blogspot.
You always say that.
I do.
Brian Kelly's blog. No, it's a mouthful. .blogspot.com.
I honestly, I'm having a real problem this week with my brain connecting to my mouth. I don't know why. It just doesn't want to work together. Yesterday was terrible.
We didn't pick up on it, Lisa. You're good.
Well, I certainly do.
Our fearless leader.
So we've actually got, I think it might be Sovereign. Let's have a look. 347.
Oh,
is that, is that Sovereign?
Hello, everybody.
Or is it the Flow?
It's the Flow.
It's the flow.
How are we?
I have been trying to get in touch with you since last week's show, by the way.
We're flowing, man.
Yeah, you know, I had muted my own self because I got it on like a loudspeaker because a friend of mine is listening with me. And then I go to unmute myself and I just end the call like a dunce. So then I couldn't reconnect because I was having internet issues. So, oh my goodness, I'm blessed to be with you guys this week. Not only in spirit.
The blessings are all ours, my friend.
Oh boy, my goodness gracious, the blessings go all around this whole world, this whole universe, man. I can't tell you guys how happy I am to just be here. What different can I say this week that I haven't said in previous weeks? I call in every week. I mean, do you have a more frequent caller? Rhetorical. We're not. I don't believe in numbers anymore. Numbers don't exist. No more measuring. No more sizes. No more servings and whatnot. No more limits. No more boundaries. You see, I'm just so prepared to mix my energy that I've always had, that I've always believed in, and allow it to spread across the planet. Like, I'm so prepared. I just want everyone to know that I'm ready for doing and being. I have a team prepared to do and be. A lot of the problem that we have is, of course, that whole representation that everyone wants to see. You know, we have this energy inside of us. We can do and be, but everyone wants to see some sort of representation. They want those ferns. They want those dinars. They want those whatever you want to call them. And it's debilitating to our energy, of course. I want to courtesy notice the dollar. I just want to courtesy notice, like, the dollar, like, damn you. You know, but that's why I haven't used many courtesy notices, because I'm like, oh, I don't hate the dollar. I don't not like the representation of our energy. Some of us don't understand energy, so we need a representation to play a game real quick, to then learn how these tools work, and then bam. Then we've got the true essence of our energy. Then we can put those tools down and just strike nails through wood ourselves with our hands. We can just form boards together with our own mind energy. Just forget glue and tape and
And you know what, Tom?
I know why they call him Flo now.
You know what, Flo?
He's on.
I had a thought about this whole representation of money. Even the representations of money are transforming. You notice now with this whole anonymous thing where they're writing these messages on their dollar bills.
Oh, yeah. Flo, can you...
Oh, my God.
We've got a lot of echo.
I'm sorry. That's me because I've got it on the loudspeaker. Let me take it off.
So now these FRNs are actually becoming instruments of information.
That's a very interesting concept, actually. Might have to get out the texter and do a bit of tagging.
I don't know what's going on right now.
We're getting an echo back from somewhere in the system or from Sovereign, but that's okay. Because I was just thinking, what a great way to actually put a message through the system is to just write on every note that flows through your hands.
I've got these great little business cards that were made up by Amit to put together the OPPT meetup group in Sydney. He had a box full made up and he gave me a huge handful. And I had a great time the other day putting some more out in cafes around town. And you just know you've left a little energy bomb somewhere. It's beautiful. And so this week I'm doing some more. I'm printing out flyers. I've got two packages that I'm putting together, one to go down to the police, one to go to the bank. So hopefully I'll get that done before next Monday night, Tuesday show. And I'll let you know how that went. It just feels good. It feels, the energy behind all of this is so beautiful that you actually do feel like you're doing something positive and you're not fear-mongering, you're not alarming people, you're not scaring them. I think we might have to just mute Flo for a sec. Is that coming from him?
Wasn't me, Lisa.
Was it one of your trains, was it, Lisa?
No. All right, I've muted you, Flo. Sorry, there were some weird noises going on there. I didn't even know what I was saying, yeah. Someone else pick up the ball. I dropped it.
You were talking about the beautiful energy. And we are actually, we're transforming the world. I mean, this is what we do.
It's energetic terraforming.
Well, it's funny because I was, you know, you talk about dropping love bombs in cafes and courtesy notice and all that stuff. I was looking for a graphic for the Daryl interview for my blog today because you got to put a little picture, you know, for all the blog posts I put up unless it's a video. And I was Google imaging searching for stand your ground. And I found this awesome picture that says keep calm and stand your ground because I like that. And Daryl is the perfect illustration of keeping calm and standing his ground. But when I put in stand your ground into the Google images, every other picture had a gun in it.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah. And I was just like, oh, my God. And that's when the greater population thinks of the idea of standing your ground, it's like don't get in between me and whatever else is out there because I'm strapped. I'm going to bust out my 9 and bust a cap. And how opposite that energy is to, doing things like Chase is doing and spreading this information out there, getting it out there organically. I mean, the courtesy notice, I actually just got a response back from Chase. I could actually read this. I finally got a response back from Chase for my – everybody always asks me about my car loan. I haven't heard from them since January, and I just got a response back. I guess I could read it if you want. It's kind of funny. This is the first – and it's signed in wet ink. It says – I have enclosed a copy of the agreement and your payment history. Together, these – oh, our records indicate that on February 25th, 2013, you submitted to Chase a courtesy notice for closing on your past due account. To date, this debt still debt remains unpaid. I have enclosed a copy of the agreement and your payment history. Together, these documents validate the debt owed to Chase in accordance with this with the requirements of the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act. In addition, in accordance with the Fair Credit Reporting Act, the enclosed agreement validates the reporting of the original trade line while the payment history validates the balance owed. Chase is not required to provide the additional documentation requested or to answer by affidavit and declined to do so. This is the best part right here. Pursuant to – oh, in your correspondence, you indicate that you have terminated your contract with Chase. The document, the documentation you have provided does not in any way amend or modify your contractual agreement with Chase. Accordingly, Chase denies your claims in their entirety. Chase asserts that your contract remains legally binding and you remain responsible for monthly payments on your account in accordance with the terms of your contract. Pursuant to your request, we have noted your account to cease all communications as required by law. Mr. Kelly, while we understand that you may disagree with our position, we believe that your concerns have been fully investigated, blah, blah, blah. So they'll be getting another courtesy notice.
Sounds like
Brian,
invoice
what time. What they get is an invoice. Okay, you don't have to re-courtesy notice them. That's the whole idea. You just send them a bill. So any communication back from them, they've triggered the terms and conditions now, and you send them an invoice. Okay,
that's the whole
principle of the courtesy notice. So that you don't re-courtesy notice. You just send them a bill every time they attempt a communication.
Well, the time has come.
Mm-hmm. So we've got another couple of calls here, guys. You ready to take them?
Yeah.
Let's see what happens. Who have we got? Area code 773.
Hi, Lisa. This is Carlos again from LA.
Hey,
Carlos. But anyway, I just wanted to ask Heather, but apparently she's not there, about expanding on the it is the moment thing. But if not, maybe you guys can answer if you know a little bit more about that. I wait for any answer if you have some.
Well, all I know is she keeps saying May is the time for the finale. Now, your guess is as good as mine, to be honest, is what that means. Anybody else?
Somebody emailed me or put a comment on the blog, the same thing. And I think when Heather says this is the moment, I think she's talking about, like, everything all coming to a head all at the same time, whether it be the IUV exchange, Project 13, the end of the finale. You know, this is the moment. To me, it's like the culmination of all of these things that are now coming to a point or coming to fruition. So, but then again, you know, you never really know what Heather is talking about. Some of the time, you have to feel it with your heart as opposed to try to understand it with your mind. But that, for me personally, that's the way that I understand it.
Well, Heather and I had a funny exchange. Sorry, go ahead.
No,
this is the Mexican
the
amigo,
I,
right?
Yes.
Right. the way I understood it was that some kind of message for the bankers or something that went to them, and then because I think Dee commented that somebody quitted their post or their whatever they were watching, the monitor or something. Well, I know it was metaphorical, but I guess she had a message for them. But anyway, that's it. Thanks for taking my call.
Oh,
thank
you,
man.
Thanks for calling in, Carlos.
Thanks.
So, yeah, Bobby, you wanted to say something too.
I did. I just think that when you start to focus on a date, it's like I don't know if anyone has ever seen the double slit experiment. But in the double slit experiment, when they're observing then all of that possibility immediately collapses. And now you just have this single electron acting like this marble. And it's the focus. It's the focus that holds it in place. And when you release that focus, it's free to be in a lots of different possibilities, so many things more open. And I've been finding, you know, and this is probably one of the things that happens in the transformation, and which is why it makes, when you finally do awaken, it makes you such a terrible employee, is that I'm no longer time-driven. I just can't, you know, people, you know, when we even have our meetings, they happen kind of when they happen. They're not scheduled. It's a different way of being, and I'm finding it very, very hard to schedule or to try to stick to a schedule. It just is so
What's
limiting.
A schedule?
Yeah, exactly.
It's funny, Heather never even knows what day it is. She's like, is it Monday? Like, Friday, Heather.
There's some questions in the chat room in regards to Project 13 and the IUV that I think we probably should clear up based on what we know. From what I understand, when Project 13 first goes live, it's going to be done, it'll be done in stages. The first part that goes live will be the Facebook equivalent. Does anybody else know anything different to that?
What I've learned recently over the course of the last week is that Caleb is doing everything he can to keep a lot of the detail about Project 13 totally under wraps until it's out. Rightfully so. You know, it's a very sensitive project, so what we've put out, I think, so far already is the extent of my understanding of it. I think the article that we put out yesterday, which was the summation of, I can't remember the guy's name now, Peter, whatever he put out, the bullet point list of the way he saw Project 13, the IUV exchange manifesting, which supposedly had a lot of was pretty accurate as far as Heather's assumption. But as far as, do we have any new updates since yesterday? No, and that doesn't surprise me.
What I'm saying, though, is, Brian, I don't think all of that's going to go live on the same day.
You know, I don't think it will either.
No, I think it's scheduled to evolve into all of that that was mentioned in that article. But I don't, to my knowledge, it's not going to be all systems go live on the same day.
That's the way I understand it as well.
Okay. All right. Carlos, again, thanks for calling in, man. I love his energy. He's lovely.
Mexican amigo.
And we've got area code 612. With a lot of yelling going on.
Loud noises.
612.
Yes, it's me, Elizabeth.
That's hello, Elizabeth.
What
are you screaming at?
I just got home. My grandkids. I was trying to unpack my bag. But how are you guys?
We're great. How are you?
Good. Just really short, I want to add a good idea. Somebody just had it a while ago, but it's too good to pass up, you guys. Something we can do. What I'm going to do is get a permanent marker, and all my money, I'm going to get lots of Federal Reserve notes. I'm going to stop using my card a lot, which I don't anyway. But all the little paper that comes in my hand, I'm going to write one people, oppt.com or whatever the thing is. I'm going to write on every little note that comes through my little hand.
Great idea. Great idea.
There you go. There you go. Some serious doing at play.
And I don't know if it's against the law, but don't do it if you think it's against the law, but I challenge everybody to do it. Everyone. Come on, guys, do it. Why not, right?
I did see some of the examples from what are they called, Anonymous, and they have completely covered the note in writing. And I know that some people will not accept them if you do that. They'll consider them too defaced, and you won't be able to actually use them. So if you just in a corner, or, you know, don't completely write all over it, because you don't want to make it worthless to you. But something like that would be great.
If you decide to write over a couple of them, write on a couple of them all over, guess where it'll go? It'll go to the no use, and it'll go straight to the bad boys, and they'll get to read it, won't they?
Woo-hoo! That's exactly right.
It's not against common law to deface FRN notes.
Well, thank you for that, Brian, and I know we're under common law because the one people probably trust foreclosed on everything of the bad boy world, right?
Yeah.
Something like that.
They did. The dead boy world, that's an interesting turn of phrase.
Bad boy, I think she said.
Bad boy world.
Oh.
Equally.
Well, I like the dead boy world, too.
The dead boy, it's, you know, corporations are dead entities.
They are.
So.
Absolutely. And we're coming to the life boy world, right?
Yes, we are indeed.
Yeah.
Thank
with
you
our brothers and sisters, galactic-wise.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up again, because it is a great idea. Because they all do end up back where they originated from, and in the hands of the bank teller. So, yes.
Hey, and by the way, I did a marathon with everybody that called on the phone that couldn't come by computer for the UFO disclosure, the citizens hearing. It was awesome. You know, and I pick up on detail. So the very last board or two, you know, Greer even said, I believe they know it's close, and how could they even have that
Oh, we lost her.
Uh-oh.
Sorry, Elizabeth, we lost you. Okay. Have you been watching the disclosure, Brian?
Well, do you mean did I watch the end of it?
Any of it?
Yeah, no, I watched quite a bit of it. I haven't watched all the highlights yet. I mean, gosh, it's 40 hours. But the closing remarks from Carolyn Kilpatrick were definitely a highlight. Some of the testimony, there was one I posted a video on the blog. It was a testimony of 10 police officers in the UK that were all together that saw, and they all corroborated the same story, and they finally came forward, a ship that was the length of 3 football fields, and it was like within 100 yards of them. It was really close. So I don't know. You know, it's going to be interesting. I think that actually Chris brought it up in the interview with Julian. If anybody hasn't listened to that, I've only listened to the first half. But talking about what that did, what the citizens hearing on disclosure did energetically to kind of push things forward. And Julian still stays very strong on the probability levels of a mass flyover type scenario happening over the course of the next 4 to 6 weeks. And in the interview that he put out last week, he said, I mean, he literally at one point said that everybody in the world, all 7.5 billion people, would see this activity that's going to be going on in the skies, which is preparation for, you know, what I understand as to being first contact. You got to remember with the stuff that Julian puts out, his information, Chris could probably speak to this a little bit better than I, it's based on probability levels. And so anytime he sees something as being really strong, it's very strong from a probability standpoint, meaning there's a chance that it couldn't happen. But he's still, based on some of the comments that he made today, is seeing that as being a very strong probability over the course of the coming weeks. So he said, make sure you have your cameras ready, and not just the phone cameras, something with some really good optical zoom.
Yeah.
Actually, speaking of sightings, though. Oh, okay, go on, Chris.
I was just going to say the way that Julian described it was really that there will be a ramp up. So if you take what we've got at the moment with, you know, a few sightings here and there throughout the week in various places, there's our baseline. Ramping it up to a point where virtually everybody has seen something. So I wouldn't necessarily describe it as a mass flyover, but it's going to be obvious and very widespread, and should penetrate the mainstream media. So As he said, keep your camera ready. We may have a mass flyover, you know, at some point much later this year, but for this next couple of months, it's education. They're actually enforcing. They're actually educating us.
New York Times reported on the citizens hearing on disclosure as well, and it wasn't in the weird news section either. It was in their politics section, believe it or not.
I actually felt it was quite a neutral report. They're usually sneering in the New York Times, but they didn't. They're quite factual. So I took that as being a step away from their previous policies. Good sign.
Yep, I agree.
Now, just another heads up that Julian is doing a radio show as of this week. I believe it's going to start on Saturday for the US, Saturday afternoon, Sunday morning for those of us in Australia. And the details of that, when it's all been scheduled and organised, will be on the Facebook page for 5D Media Network. So if you want to keep up if you want to keep up to date with those, please go and like the 5D Media Facebook page.
Yeah, just to preface something about Julian. Julian, for the most part, observes energy, and the contact that he has with others is all energetically based. So he actually isn't a channel. Okay, his contract with himself is to be as impartial and as analytical as possible. So he's quite amazing to work with. It's a real buzz, so encourage people to actually listen to that.
It is a buzz. And I was just going to mention, somebody said it in the chat room, and Thomas Hughes, who joins us every now and then, our Sasquatch guy, rang the other week after last week's show, completely kind of blown away because the Sasquatch are making themselves known a lot more as well. There was an incident where a woman that he works with, and I can't remember where she lives. I don't know if you can remember, Chris. But
it was in the United States, and I think southern states. Could have been elsewhere though, but definitely United States.
And she was sort of given the impulse to go to the local park really early in the morning. It's like 5 a.m. or something. She got there and sat on a park bench, and a Sasquatch came out onto the path in full view. And she was like, "What are you doing?" And he said, "It's okay, whatever happens, you'll handle it." And two people came past doing a morning jog, I believe it was, and saw him. And she said, "Don't worry, it's just my cousin in a suit. We're planning to scare somebody, you know, like it's a surprise." And they went, "Oh, okay, no worries," and kept going. And it turned out that guy, the guy that was of the two, was a reporter for a newspaper. And he actually put a story in that day in the paper about how he happened to come across a guy in a Sasquatch suit. But apparently they're coming out and they're saying it's time. And one of the other things that Thomas does is monitor the obituaries, which sounds very maudlin, but he has a reason. And he is noticing that the number of people leaving the planet is kind of exponentially growing. And he's only checking one newspaper in the Texas area. And because one of the reasons he's doing that is because the Sasquatch have been telling him for some time that they are helping people to transition, those who need to. But so are many of the others, the little people, he called them, and basically the pixies and the fairies, and everybody else is coming out to play. All the ones that we have not traditionally been able to see for some time are starting to make themselves known. That was his message.
And there was one other interesting thing about that incident with the Sasquatch on the on the path was when they ran past, he said hi.
That's right, out loud, yeah, not telepathically.
Mm-hmm. It wasn't telepathically?
Mm.
No, it was out loud.
Well, did he have an accent?
I've got no idea.
No, I did not.
I bet he had an Aussie accent.
Yep.
G'day. Did he say good day or did he say hi? Was it a hello?
It was just a hi. But it would have been a bit like running past Harry and the Hendersons for the joggers.
Well, it's funny, you know, with all this talk, we've been talking on the show about this for a long time, that the number of people leaving the planet has just been, you know, sort of exponentially growing for the last year. And I've been relatively untouched by it. I mean, I've known of it. There have been some strange accidents. We live, you know, on the coast, lots of beaches, lots of people doing rock fishing and things like that, which is a highly dangerous thing to do. So, we're losing people there, road accidents, freaky accidents, people falling off cliffs. But on Sunday or Monday, my mum rang to tell me that my uncle had passed. And the day after, another close friend had a stroke. I was like, okay, it's getting closer to home.
Wow.
Yeah.
I bet you, I at one point I looked for, I was trying to find studies, like global studies, just from Googling it, to see if there's like a anybody that's basically done the same thing as Thomas has, except on more of a nationwide or global scale. And I couldn't find anything, but I bet you if somebody did it, that it would, the numbers would be absolutely staggering. I mean, there's got to be a census somewhere. I imagine that's the kind of data that certain people wouldn't want out, but who knows.
Well, I know that there are, the police are, in this country, both locally and federally, are under orders not to talk about the number of suicides they attend because it's just gone through the roof.
Mm-hmm.
So why...
One of the things that Thomas related to us was that... I'll try and use the exact words that he used, was that the Sasquatch told him that within two moons... they would be focusing on helping a lot of souls leave the planet. Now, that was about... if a moon is a month, a lunar month, that was about 1.5 months ago. So the time is fast approaching for this finale. Now, with Heather's information about finale, one has to remember that Heather is working in the energetic realms and that the physical realms lag behind it. So if she's saying May's the big finale energetically, then I'd be looking for June for it to play out physically. That's my view on the way these things work. Because the energetic level, the energetic events seem to lead the physical events. They always seem to happen in advance to create the space, and then the event actually occurs down in physicality. That's one of my theories, folks.
No, I think you're absolutely right on that. It has to happen energetically first.
Indeed, there has to be, and this is something that really comes across with Julian's work. If you talk to him about how reality plays out, that the energetics play out in front of the physical, because it actually has to work that way. Which is actually why the controllers flag false flag events. They have to create an energetic space for it out there, even though we don't realize it consciously, unless we happen across the Facebook page, you know, the announcements or the messages on Facebook pages, fake Facebook pages, about a bombing that hasn't happened yet. That's what I'm talking about. They actually create an energetic space for the event to allow it to happen. But, of course, being a negative event, if people find out that they're giving advance warning, they don't do it because it won't have the effect they're after. But
well, we've had that conversation before. You know, it's the reason they put movies out and publish books and allow certain information to leak, is because they actually need us and our energy to make it happen by giving us, you know, what did 1984 do? The book, remember?
Yeah, it works both positively and negatively too. It's not like that's the only thing that's going on, is this negative stuff being forecast. It's the positive stuff being forecast.
One of the documents that got brought forward in the Citizens Hearing on Disclosure was an actual document from, oh man, I can't remember who the sender was, and I guess that's a really important detail, but it was to some of the biggest movie producers and agencies in Hollywood. Basically giving them royalties for putting out movies for alien attacks and anything poking fun at the idea of extraterrestrials and everything in between. I mean, it's just as much effective to make them little green men with like little horns as it is to make them you know, crazy monsters from outer space that are coming here to take over the world. And so, you know, I put one of the videos of some really powerful testimony. I put it on my blog, and then I posted it on CNN's Facebook page, and it just showed one of the responses was just a reader, and it showed how effective that campaign was, because his response was, oh, I prefer unicorns to aliens. And that's just their the money and the smear campaign and at work. We can only imagine how long that's been going on for, and I'm sure that that's just one example of that kind of business happening on so many countless levels.
Absolutely, that's if you follow the work of Peter Shelton and Michael Monk. We project reality as in our consciousness field. The reality we're in is a combination of a base pattern supplied by the planet. Okay, so you know the landscape we're walking through is supplied by Gaia. Everything else is our projection, and it's being constantly reinforced. You know, nanosecond by nanosecond by 7 billion people. That's why it's so thick and heavy and dense and real, and that. What's going on in this material we're being presented to stir up our imaginations is that it's leading us to project. That's
you know, I'm not somebody who watches zombie movies. I don't like them. But there's one film I want to watch because, to me, the analogy, was, as soon as I saw the trailer, was perfect. You know, we talk about corporations being dead entities. And Warm Bodies is a zombie movie, zombies being corporations in my mind, and one particular zombie falls in love with a living human, and it's how through his love for her he becomes whole again and he becomes human again. And I just think that's classic. It's a perfect analogy for what we're going through right now. We're going to love these dead corporations to a point where the beings inside them become alive again.
Mm-hmm. Well, isn't it, that's part of almost every culture's prophecy, that there'd be some sort of resurrection, that the dead would rise.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's a very interesting take on it. You know, because in fact, all you do is you strip away the fake corporate licensing given out by governments that are just corporations masquerading, and what you're left with is everything that you actually need. If you've got a car manufacturing plant, you've got engineers and workers and materials and factory, and you don't need the government overlay, the control, the taxation, the regulation. You just need the good stuff that's actually creative. And, you know, that there's a what you're talking about, you know, reviving the dead is simply a matter of stripping away the fake overlay, and then you're left with the living humans and their creativity. So, yeah, good metaphor, Bob. Dead silence.
Okay.
I was going to make a comment I made. I always took Lisa for more of a vampire kind of girl.
Hey, I'm a Twilight fan, and I'm a proud Twilight fan. I have teenage girls who got me into it.
Oh, girls.
And it became our thing. We went and saw all the Twilight movies together at the movies. Yes.
Of course.
A Twilight mum, I am.
Oh, okay.
It's embarrassing.
There's a Facebook page for that, is there?
I believe. Oh, look, yes.
I'm sure.
Yeah. I never bought a T-shirt claiming which team I was on.
Oh, but, you were team Jacob or team...
Team Jacob.
Who were you, though, Lisa? Come on, you can tell us.
I was vampire all the way, yeah.
Yeah, but what team were you on?
I've gone blank on his name. What's his name?
You were not the Team Jacob guy. You were the vampire guy. Team,
yeah.
Shoot, somebody in the chat room can not help us out.
I've gone blank.
Brittany will know. Hey, Brittany, who's the other guy other than Jacob?
Edward, that's it. Oh. Team Edward.
Yeah.
He sparkles. He sparkles. Okay. Now, we've had 67 people like the 5D Media Facebook page. Now, you know, not to put too fine a point on it, but there's 287 of you in the chat room, so come on. So please go and like it and share that first post, the experience, cool new perspective, the picture with the Buddha. That would be great. Thank you very much. See how many we can get in the second hour. Too funny. I should take another call.
When I just surveyed Brittany to get the Team Edward thing, she goes, "Come on, stop pretending like you haven't watched all the movies with me." I admit it. Sorry, guys.
They are so brilliant. I love them.
There you go.
Where is this going?
one of the other things that Julian will be talking about on his show is manifestation. Now, because we're all doing it now and we don't know it, but the energetics are leading to a point where we'll be able to manifest consciously at will eventually, should we turn our minds to it. Absolutely fascinating subject and heavily related to the concepts we've just been discussing, because it's the conscious extension of the unconscious manifestation that we've been doing all along. Lots of fun. So, yeah, join Julian. Have a blast.
I received a Skype message today from a woman named Annie, and she was wanting to get her hands on the original Swiss Indo documents in Indonesian, because she's from there, and she's got a lot of friends who could help to translate the original documents. And I'm trying to find the actual message. She was talking about her being a witness to people that can actually manifest things out of thin air over there. And she's either seen it with her own eyes or knows people that have seen it with their own eyes. So these things exist. It's just we haven't, as the collective, remembered how to do it yet. But you better believe once a big handful of people, just like anything, learn a new skill, it just spreads like wildfire. So nothing is too far out there these days.
Yeah, because we've had the belief instilled in us for hundreds of years that it's not possible, or that if it is, it's work of the devil. And we just need to change that base belief, and it will actually, the 100th monkey effect will, it'll be that love virus you were talking about before.
Mm.
But we also got to be careful, because serious comment here, if the ability to manifest suddenly became available, people in a state of fear will manifest their fears, and that will be not useful. Let me just put it that way. So I feel it's going to be a slowish process and a very much a learning process to take out the fear factor.
Well, I think on the other side of that, one could say that the energies that would allow a great number of people to be able to manifest would support kind of a concurrent increase or shift in consciousness, to the extent that the fear aspect of manifesting the things that you're afraid of would not be a possibility, or the people that are still in that state are not yet prepared to be able to manifest those things. I'm thinking if you evolve to the point to where you can manifest out of thin air, you're already past the point of being so fearful of it that you're not all of a sudden going to end up, in a tar pit because you were freaked out or what have you. So, this type of stuff, it's fun to speculate and make assumptions, but no one really knows with this kind of thing exactly how it's going to work. That's what makes it so fun to talk about, because there's an infinite number of possible options in every single moment. I mean, it's just endless.
It is endless.
I was going to mention that earlier, last couple of days, I had this funny exchange with Heather, and it was because my head, the way I explained it to her is that my head has been under the illusion for the last 45 years that it's been running the show. And, okay, I'm someone who's followed my heart a lot and my intuition, and yet when the head sees options for me, when the head can see clear paths and choices, then it so does a number on me. And what I've noticed happening more and more as the course of this year has gone on is that the options that my head can see are becoming fewer and fewer, and how can I put this, more and more short term. So now, right as I sit here today, I kind of am in a situation just with circumstances in my life changing where my head cannot come up with a solution, any solution. So because of that, I'm actually free. 3 days ago, when my head was able to do, okay, well, I could do this, 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 or this, I was a mess. And now all of those options have gone or changed to the point where my head's got nowhere to go. So now it's purely heart. And it's actually liberating for me to be in a place where I have got no clue what I'm doing, no clue what's coming next, no clue what path to go down, no clue what decision to make. It sounds like the scariest place to be, but actually for me it's the most liberating because my head just gets out of the way. It's got nowhere to go.
That just brought up for me that Jill Bolt Taylor TED Talk, you know, where she goes through the stroke of insight and she totally disconnects, a brain surgeon, she totally disconnects from her whole left hemisphere of her brain, and the right hemisphere of the brain, it's all about, it doesn't think linearly. It's about eternal presence. There is nothing to think about in that state. It's only to feel and experience whatever's happening in that moment, the connection with your being and all that is, and losing, being kind of getting blurred, the distinction between what separates your body, your embodiment, from everything else. You know, and then snapping back and all of a sudden being in the left brain where it thinks linearly, and it's all about what do I feel? How do I feel about this right now? Where do I need to be in an hour? Where do I need to be tomorrow? What happened yesterday that can help me figure out where I need to go tomorrow? And it's that when you're in that heart space, you're fully in that right hemisphere, and just experiencing things as a conscious observer with total detachment from, you know, any particular expected outcome. And what a gift that is when you can stay in that presence. I think that's a big part of what is powerful about meditation, is you're essentially training your mind and your heart to get into that space where it's total unadulterated presence. Nothing else matters. Everything's perfect. There's nothing to do and everything just flows. And it feels good. You just want to figure out how to get back there when you get caught up in the brain chatter.
Well, so what I'm finding with people I talk to is that if you really scratch below the surface, they're not interested in stuff anymore. They just want the stress levels gone. They want to be happy. They want to spend time with their family. That's it. That's a theme that keeps coming up whenever I have conversations. They're over the frenetic, self-destructive spiral that we all end up with, all end up in, with the way things are currently structured. And that's just a physical, a really 3D version of what Lisa said, that it's actually very freeing to get away from that materialistic mindset.
Yeah, it's, I mean, this goes back to what we were talking about last week too, with being absent limits. I mean,
Precisely.
Think about it too much, I do my head in. And I am someone who traditionally has been quite analytical. I want to know the why, and I want to know the how, and I want to know the variable what ifs. And it served me. It has served me in the past to be like that on many occasions, but it's not at the moment.
And you know what happens, though? Lisa, when you make this transformation and you're in the heart space and you can't understand how, when people start asking you questions, you end up sounding like Heather.
Oh, God help me.
Well, speaking from the absolute has a certain feeling to it. You know, when you start to cut things back to that absolute core, and you've been in that space for a while with others and really understood, you know, the bigger picture that is absolutely going on, it's like you can't unknow that experience. You can't go back from it.
No, it's
can you?
No, you can't.
You've been there and you can't go back. So everything else around you starts to look like it's behind you rather than
around
you.
Oh my God, I have to share this, and my daughter would absolutely kill me if she knew, so it's our secret.
Well, just say it very quietly.
just between
our
us.
Our secret on live radio.
She's at school.
And she's at school, can't hear it.
Yeah. She's sending me texts of all these emoticons of, you know, crying and bored and, you know, horrible. And I'm like, what's wrong? And she says, I'm upset because I'm in legal studies.
I would be too.
Yeah, she said, don't worry, nothing life-threatening, just me being fed government lies.
And then
I'm so proud right now.
Well, the apple obviously doesn't fall far from the tree.
Oh, I'm chuffed. I'm totally chuffed.
Circle is complete.
It's my daughter that I would consider, you know, the one who doesn't want to hear mum's crazy talk, you know. But
well,
she's listening. She's listening.
Yeah, I get a lot of resistance from my lads, but I know they hear it. They might not want to acknowledge it because, you know, their position they've taken is, you know, dad needs a tin hat. But they hear it and they process it. It's in there.
It's true. Oh, sorry, I had to just share that with you. Let's bring out another caller. We've got a few waiting for us. We've got area code 507. Area code 507? Nope.
Going once?
Going once, going twice.
And
okay.
Goodbye.
And goodbye. And area code 301.
Yes! Yes, yes, yes!
Oh, my God.
Oh, I like her already.
Hello, everybody. Oh, my God. It's so cool to say hello to you finally. And hi, all my friends on the chat. Judy Jandora here.
Judy.
Hi, Judy.
Hello.
Hi, Judy. I come on with a couple different names, but hi. Oh, my God, I'm getting all nervous.
you're among friends. All good.
Oh, my goodness. Thank you so much. This is really great. I have so many things I want to say. I hope you can remember at least one of them. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Chat room. But,
somebody,
you know,
said,
oh my
somebody
goodness.
In the chat room said we got a female Brian on our hands. Thank you.
Well,
sorry.
At least I can outdo you, Brian, with my giggle factor, all right?
Oh, I don't know about that. All right.
You can get a room, and we'll move on with the show.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, there's so many things I want to say. So, the whole just feeling into my being now, and I just love this whole thing. As soon as I found it, I remember watching one of your shows, Lisa, early on with this, or listening to one, and I kind of like it was over the top for me at that moment, and I let it go, and then I came back probably about a month later, and I really feel into everything these days. So I don't remember what happened yesterday most of the time.
Oh, you joined the club.
Exactly. So it's gotten to the point where literally, you know, everything that comes about these days is about how does that feel to me? And how the one thing that I want to say is that I would love to, the promptings that I'm getting, and I've had a couple of downloads, some really amazing downloads. I've shared them with you all over the time. One of them was really long, but it was so awesome. And it took, like, no time at all to write, and I don't like to write. I won't even keep a journal because I suck at it. The thing that keeps prompting me is creating this, like, imagination station. That's the word that came to me today. It sounds so childish, but it's to start intending and playing with the intentions in a group to create what we want. I was listening earlier to what is his name? Starts with an A. Chris, you were talking with him. It was
Julian.
Hello, Jay. My initial for that. but you know, he was talking about the point. One of the points he was really trying to get through was about intention and how important intention is. And my mind just kept going with, oh my goodness, we need to do this. And I wanted to get on last week, and talk about creating something where we can get together. And I know you've got chat rooms, but I'm like much better with hearing instead of writing. And I'm thinking radio show or something like that would be so amazing, where we get on and just play with creating. I know that's what we're doing here too, but.
Well, you know what? I mean, that's pretty much what this show started out as. But it's evolved. And the whole,
yeah.
You know, we were doing meditations every week and we were picking a subject and by consensus on something that we wanted to create. We'd do a meditation around it and then we'd follow that through and see what the results were, where they were showing up in the real world. And
I caught
it
a couple
like this show has evolved too much to go back to that. Exactly.
Well, I know
exactly
because there's
format.
So much information that needs to get out. People need the information. They want to hear the information. I missed that. I caught like the last two meditations, and of course, the last one, the whole show got dropped just before.
Oh.
And that sucked really big time because I loved it. Oh my gosh.
Oh,
if
you go back and listen to the archives have got them all there, which you can do.
Oh, good.
Yeah, you can do that at least at the 5dmedianetwork.com. website is where the archives are, and they've been cleaned up, and they're all complete.
Oh my gosh, I can't even tell you how I felt in the meditation. It was like it took me into a completely different place, and my whole body was vibrating. I'm actually doing that right now.
Let's keep it PG here, Judy.
Judy, are we connected on Skype or Facebook?
Facebook, yes. Judy Jandor. I think it's Ansel Jandor is what my name is on there. Skype, I'm not sure if we're connected on Skype yet. I am with Heather, although I don't want to bother her. I know she's okay, I'm busy.
Let's talk about helping you create this.
Okay, cool. Let's do. Because I can totally feel it, like, you know, playing with it and creating, because I don't think it's going to take much. I know we're on the threshold. I know that we're about to, like, pop through that alpha-omega point, that big spiral that comes to a tipping point where the, you know, everything is, like, exponential now. And it's so exciting.
Patrick O in the chat room says, Judy really needs to cheer up.
Everybody thinks that.
Seriously, you're such a downer. Like, stop.
I'm so impressive. I know.
It's contagious.
Please forgive me.
That was funny. Oh, man. I can't stop.
Well,
laughing.
One of the things that's becoming clear is that as individuals we can manifest. So what about large groups? I mean, that was what the collective imagination began as. And as Lisa says, it's kind of gone in a different direction due to just circumstances and need. But there is always this underlying aspect of we're creating this as we go along. And that's why last week seems so unreal compared to this week, because I think the conscious creation is accelerating to the point where, you know, we, as you say, we could all just pop through.
Yeah.
When the energetics are right.
I think there. Boom. I remember getting that vision like 15 years ago, or maybe 13. But I had that vision of that getting to this point, and I feel like we're like so right on the threshold.
Surfing. That's what we're doing.
Yeah.
Surfing.
Yeah.
And the wave's about to break.
Well, and for me right now, what I've been told is to hold this space. I keep saying I'm holding this space of nothingness. I mean, I let go of, like, bank cards, or not bank cards, but it's the only thing I use besides the tiny bit of cash that I write. And I'm the one that wrote, I was the one that wrote the thing about writing on the money, because I do. the tiny bit that I actually have. It's amazing how I'm living right now. It's crazy, ridiculous, but it's wonderful. And I'm like holding the space for this. It's like this nothing space almost, just a pure potential for this to flow through right through the center.
Perfect.
I'm not the only one.
Excellent. Excellent doing, Judy. Excellent.
Well, see, that's the energetics that Julian's reported on. That's kind of the purity and simplicity, flexibility, and everybody's beginning to add to that.
Yeah.
That's the in my theory of everything, that energetic entity that's being created is the one that's going to pop and give everyone else the wake-up call. It's not going to come from the outside. It's going to come from us.
I agree. You know, I also had a group. This was wonderful until I let go of my house a year ago. I created a group on meetup.com called Soul Journey. And it was no rules, nothing. We just meet at my house. Somebody bring a bottle of wine. Somebody bring some food. And we sat down around a table for every 2 weeks for 4 years. And just talked about anything spiritual without outside the box. And it was crazy amazing. It literally created hundreds and hundreds of people in this community that have gone out and it's just exponentially grown. It's like that, you know, a drop of water in the pond. I'm not the only one that has done this around here. This town is amazing. I literally live in a town that is mostly awakened. It's incredible. But
where is that, Judy?
Yeah, where is that?
I know, it's incredible. It really is. Frederick, Maryland. And I live just outside of it, but the town itself, you wouldn't even believe it. It's just the most amazing space. So many awakened people and so much goodness, so much energy, open, healing, wonderful spiritual energy that's just flowing all over the place, and they have, it's just a wonderful place to live. But there are lots of people like me who have done this in this area. There must be a vortex or something around here. I don't know, but it's really cool.
It sounds like Byron Bay.
Mm. It sounds like what?
A place called Byron Bay in northern New South Wales.
Cool.
It's the same sort of thing. It's the town of hippies, and it's where the rainbow serpent, the tale of the rainbow serpent ends.
Oh, cool. Yeah, it's amazing what just a little drop in the pond can do in holding a space that's open that allows people to come. I mean, so many people would come and go, oh, my God, I've been waiting. I've been looking for something, someplace to come and just talk, you know, just discuss this, just to play with it and open it and that kind of thing. And, you know, it's so simple. It's so simple to do that. It's just a matter. And I was not a, I'm not a joiner. I don't do anything if it's structured unless I do it myself. And then I don't structure it. You know, I had no rules. I didn't charge any money for it. All I said was, you know, if you can bring a little something to share, that's fine. But come and let's enjoy.
I want to do that out here. I live in the perfect community for something like that. Is this an existing meetup group?
What's that?
Is this an existing meetup? Is this through Meetup? Do you have it set up
as a
meetup?
It was through Meetup. Yeah, I mean, I started it. I had to quit I had to give up my house and I let go of everything that I owned, and so I haven't been doing that. But the community itself has expanded, so I don't really need to do it right now at this point. But I just started a Meetup group and I called it Soul Journey, and I put a little write up and said, "This is what I want, and this is, you know, what I'm holding space for." And people started, I mean, there were a couple of hundred people, and I met new people all the time. I had new people coming all the time, and I had many, many new groups that started because of it. And, you know, I can't even imagine how much it's still expanding.
Wow, so it's cool.
Just, yeah, anybody can do it.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much, Judy, for calling in and sharing your laughter with us. Lovely.
Thank you.
Thanks, Judy.
Thank you so much for all you do. Your energies are so pure, so real, and I wouldn't be here. So thank you, all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Right back.
Dang, the meat and potatoes of that compliment got cut off.
Yeah, that was my fault, just for a second there.
Sorry. Thanks, Judy.
I'm going to get you two on a call together and record you.
Hey,
giggling.
Judy.
And see how long you can go for.
Judy, any interest in co-hosting a show with me?
Oh, I would love to. Anytime. Brian, I'm on your Facebook page. I friended you a little while back. I'll post a little note in there and say, hey, it's me, one that can beat you on the giggles.
Maybe we can talk to Lisa about getting us some airtime on the 5D Media Network.
Oh, that would be awesome.
That
would be so awesome.
Unless they laughter is the best medicine. People could just tune into you two giggling for half an hour and cure themselves.
Well, Thomas Hughes has some great Sasquatch knock knock jokes.
So
it would be your first and every week caller.
I'm not so sure we need them, but that would be fun.
This reminds me of the Laughing Buddha, YouTube video. So funny. Thanks, Judy. Facebook me and we'll talk about it.
Thank you all. I love you all. Thank you so much.
We love you too.
Bye,
Judy.
Bye.
Oh, well, too funny. Lots of laughs in this show. That's nice. I've needed this, actually. Area code 808.
Aloha.
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 Hello.
Hey, how's it going, everyone?
Good.
Really well.
Wow, awesome to get through. Tried a few times before, but I don't know, the show got cut off and all kind of weird stuff happened. But, man, it's great to be connected with you guys.
What's your name?
My name's Kalani.
How do I spell
the
that?
Spirit, my family name. K-A-U-H-A-N-E.
Sorry, slow down and say that again.
Yeah, it's Ka, K-A. Yeah, K-A, Ka, which is like the. And Uhane is spirit.
Ka Uhane. Ooh,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Like
Uhane. Yeah.
That's cooler than Brian.
So what was that?
That's a cooler name than Brian.
Oh, man. Right on. Hey, you guys are just awesome. Like, I just feel like when I listen to, you know, the Collective Imagination and, you know, the shows with opt-in, I feel like I'm, like, sitting with my people with, like, a bunch of, like, shaman and priestess. It's unreal, dude. Like, it's, I'm kind of in that community here in Hawaii. Hawaii's got, like, a high concentration of, like Taoist masters and stuff that left communist China and stuff. And just, it's pretty cool. Like, so I got to learn a lot about, like, cultivation. And I don't know, I it's funny how I, like, happened into opt-in. It was a really cool experience. I was at Waimea Valley on Oahu, on the North Shore, and I'm a practicing kahuna. This is something that was passed through our family because the church has kind of shut it down, and so the Hawaiians just kind of did it underground. And so anyway, my uncle, like, taught me some stuff, and I was practicing it at Waimea, and the police kicked me out, and you know, I was pretty upset. I've been involved with sovereignty, so I knew something about common law and all that, and I knew that the media, like, they didn't interview us when we had demonstrations, and then we'd never see it on the news, you know, they'd never see it in the papers, and just kind of knew kind of early on in the 90s, like, how the media, how that works and all that, and I don't know. So I'm there, I get kicked out of Waimea, and I go on KP's site, and he has opt-in, and he's been throwing it up for a while, but...
Yeah, KP was part of... He was one of the first blogs...
Read it, and I was just like, oh, my God.
To put
I'm
it
sorry.
Out. KP's site was... He was one of the first blogs to put the information out to the public.
Oh, yeah. And it was like, you guys are talking my language, man. It was cool because there was, like, the spirituality wrapped up with legal. It was like... I've been searching for that for the longest time because I'd get involved with these groups, but then there was always, like, some weird agenda, man, like, behind it. Like, it was, like, either racially motivated or something, you know what I mean? Like, it just wasn't pono. And that, like, opt came up pono, man. It totally resonated with me. So I gave the police courtesy notices. I went back, I camped, and they took all my stuff, like $2,000 worth of stuff. I had like solar stuff. I live like, you know, I'm houseless, but the whole island's my home, so. And I just go from one temple to another, yeah, and I do my kahuna thing. And so they took all my stuff. I did 3 days in jail, had to like post bail and all that. Kind of felt, but it was just an amazing feeling being able to know that, you know what I mean, like legally, like there was this law that actually backs me now. Like it's got my back. And there was this group that was like tapped into something that was beyond just the surface stuff. And I don't know, I just really want to express my gratitude, man. Like I didn't get my stuff back. I did the invoices, I did all that, you know, and I'm just, you know, I'm letting heaven take care of that. You know what I mean? Like I put it out there. It's, you know what I mean? The energy knows, it's written. And another thing I just wanted to say is that I'm sorry, dude, am I?
No, dude, good. We're eating up everything you're saying right now. Like, such an inspiring story.
The manifestation thing, like, what I was taught about manifesting, like, you know, people, I think it was somebody commented, like, oh, what if you're fearful and then they're going to manifest messed up shit? It's like, dude, we're already doing that. You know what I mean? Like, you know, sure, and that's what we produced. And I, from what I was taught, what my uncle taught me and what other masters have taught me is that you have to integrate with the characteristic of the universe. And the characteristic of the universe for Taoists is truth. For Buddhists, it's compassion, you know. And for me, it's truth, compassion, and forever, endurance. The three combos, that's the characteristic that makes the planets rotate. You know, they rotate on that force. And if we integrate with that, it already acts as enforcement right there. That, like, that acts as a filter. Because basically what I was taught is you're not going to be given these massive creative powers if you do not integrate with the universe. You can't, like, it's like a universal law kind of thing. Like, they can't let you in heaven, some maniac in heaven. You know what I mean? Like, with these creating powers. You know, it would cause too much disruption. That's just what I was taught. But then you guys kind of like expanded that for me because absent limits, you know, and no protocol and all that. But I was just like, I don't know. I still struggle with that one a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. I still think you need to like integrate with the universe, you know, like you have to have those characters.
The difference between absent limits, it's absent limits, but it's still within
universal law. Yeah.
Your absent limits in your ability, but that doesn't mean your absent limits in terms of what you can do to another. You know?
Yeah.
Right.
The universal law still applies.
Absolutely. It does.
Exactly. It kind of goes along the same kind of storyline where, you know, the gold, if in this new IUV exchange system, if you aren't doing business with each other with integrity, and you have some agenda, the gold's not going to stick around that much longer, you know? It's kind of falls along that same kind of line, you know? You're not going to – I totally feel everything that you just said. And what a great story you have, man. I mean, obviously you're a happy guy and it has absolutely nothing to do with having things or having any money. I mean, that's just such an inspiring, you know, story because I think there's a lot of us now that are realizing that money and happiness have absolutely nothing to do with each other, you know? And that's why I think that it's so important for stories like yours to be told because some of the happiest people in the world, there's a documentary on Netflix called Happy, and they actually go to some of the poorest countries in the world, very family-oriented. These are some of the happiest people on the planet. They have absolutely nothing except each other, enough food to live, and based on this particular documentary, and a little roof over their head when this monsoon comes in, it almost blows their house over, and they laugh and giggle their whole way through it. And gosh, what a beautiful story to be able to tell, my man, and the fact that you have the energy that you have and that you're able to share it with others, it's inspiring. I'm really glad that you called in.
Well said, Brian.
Did we listen?
extremely lost.
I don't know. Maybe we did.
Kauhana ua ua.
Yeah, I think we lost him.
So, Brian, what are you going to call your show with your new colleague?
Oh, boy, you're going to put me on the spot. I'm not going to come up with anything too weird.
All right. You're off the hook. I was just making the point. How about the Tickle Ninjas? Yeah, the Tickle Ninjas. Yeah, Tickle Ninja Show. Absolutely. No, look, that was beautifully said, Brian, and I think you really nailed it. That we, you know, it's nice to have people ringing in and saying we're helping them, we're inspiring them, but you guys are actually inspiring us too. Let's be really clear on that. This is not a one-way thing.
Absolutely.
So we appreciate your sentiments for sure.
No, it just feels like such a joy and such a privilege.
Indeed.
Okay, area code. Where are we? Area code 507.
Hello.
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 I was wondering about getting for the radio talk, the phone number for it. I wasn't able to catch it. You guys talk a little faster than I can listen.
Well, sorry about that.
Sorry, I'm not sure what you're after because you've called in. Sorry. What number?
Well, yesterday you're going to Radio 1.
Oh, people radio.
Ah, okay, I got you. Next week's Monday night in the U.S., what was called the opt-in show that you would go to Freedom Reigns to listen to, as of next week will be on this network, the 5D Media Network.
The what? It'll be where?
Five. Well, where are you listening? How are you listening to the show?
On the phone.
You've called in. Okay. If you go to Blog Talk, it's the 5D Media Network channel at Blog Talk.
Blog Talk, TALK. And then what?
5D Media Network. Are you on Facebook?
No.
I'm going to put a blog post up announcing it, too.
Yeah.
We all will.
We all will.
Yeah, look, put a blog post up with the number on it, guys, the phone number as well as the web link.
Guest caller number, yep.
Yes, that would be what our caller needs.
Will do.
Cool. Perfect.
So where will it be posted?
The optin.com website, Brian Kelly's blog. I was going to let you finish the address because apparently I muck it up every time.
Okay.
Brian, what's your blog?
It's Brian Kelly's blog. blogspot.com.
Brian Kelly, how do you spell Kelly? K-E-L-L-Y?
Yeah, K-E-L-L-Y-S, blog, Brian Kelly's blog, .blogspot, all one word, .com. Got some great other articles up there, too, just for you.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
You're welcome. Thanks for calling in.
Sure.
Thank you. Okay, area code 816. Someone's doing some seriously heavy breathing into their microphone, by the way.
Yeah, I hear that, too.
Oh, my God. I did not expect you guys to take my call, and this is the first time I've called on here.
Well, next caller.
I finally caught you guys on the air. Generally, I listen to the already recorded ones that you guys have put up. I didn't really think. And whenever I got on here, there wasn't like a passcode, and it just said hit one, so I hit one. Anyway, I really don't have a lot to say. I've been following this for quite some time. I've got a lot of other people following it, too. I'm just praying for this all to happen.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, sure.
What's your name?
My name's Mindy. You're my Facebook friend. I'm Mindy Maselli. I've been following
Mindy.
This. Yeah.
Yes, your profile pic has a
anonymous
V for Vendetta mask on it.
Yes. Okay. Yes, it does. But I mean, I'm just praying all of this happens. So, yes, what did you want to ask me?
Well, here's my response to that. First of all, it's all happening right now.
I know.
Okay. And it will be made more visible as the days and weeks progress. My question for you is, considering you kind of left it on the table, is what is it that makes you happier than anything in the world?
To see other people happy. And there's a lot of people suffering right now. And I help, I'm trying to help so many people in my community because I do study law. And I've been trying to help so many people, and I'm telling you, I am so weighed down. I mean, I am really getting tired. There's just so many people losing their homes everywhere, and it's just, I mean, it's sad. I hate it. I don't know what to do, and I'm just praying that something, I mean, I have followed you guys, and I am all for you guys. I promote you guys. It's just, I just hate seeing people lose their homes. I mean, we've sent courtesy notices out. We've done all of that. And I'm just hoping the courts will man up and do the right thing.
Yeah. Judy, there's a case that some colleagues of ours are working on at the moment, which I direct your attention at, because the work they've done in uncovering what the banks are actually doing is brilliant. And you'll find it on a website called Free Speech Australia, all one word, .com.au. Free Speech Australia. There's about five or six videos on the homepage where they go step by step right through a whole lot of different aspects of what the banks are actually doing. And that might actually assist you in the work that you're doing as well. Because what they've worked out is that the banks actually monetize the application form for the mortgage. And then they fiddle with the mortgage contract and securitize it so that they, and I think they've nailed it. I think they've got the actual procedure that's going on in the background. And that brings up other avenues for making arguments against them. They're about to run a court case in the High Court of Western Australia. And we'll be watching that very closely. Good educational material, really good. Hope it helps you.
Yeah, currently, my parents have never, ever been late, never missed a payment, never been late. And there's a bank, actually, they tried to foreclose on me, but we paid off the mortgage. I only owed 10 grand. My parents, because we asked for full disclosure on the loan, and we wrote them written letters, and they actually foreclosed on my parents. And my parents have never missed a payment, never. Anything, and they are
They just foreclosed on someone who'd never missed a payment.
Never.
So they had no cause to do that at all.
No, none.
Wow.
None.
No. All I can say is that they must be desperate, absolutely desperate.
Yeah, well, I'm telling you, as soon as this is over, they're going to get it. I'm ready to go after them. As soon as I had my dad get another loan at a different bank and leave that bank, I said, because as soon as you leave that bank, we'll deal with that bank. But, yeah, it's amazing. And they actually threatened to foreclose on my son's loan, which he has never been late, never missed a payment.
So this is, when I say this, I think the banks are absolutely desperate. So there are some guys I've been having discussions with about various kinds of big projects, and one of them is due to get a fairly large payment from a previous business deal. I mean, a really big one. And part of the he's been trying to get it through the banks for 18 months, and part of the problem is the banks have so little cash in them now, I don't think they can actually do it. You know, I think essentially the money came into them, and they had to use it, you know, to bail themselves out. So, you know, what I'm trying to say to you is I think that the system's deconstructing in front of us, and we're at that last hard stage when they're desperately trying to do everything they can to rake in money to prop themselves up. Mm. And the unfortunate thing is so many people are suffering because of it, because they have no business foreclosing on people who have stuck to their contract. That's just criminal.
This is the end game. I mean, it's a, I think that's kind of a tough horse pill size thing for a lot of people to swallow, to really understand and believe that we're really at the end of the game here. You know, because there's a lot of expectation that's built into certain things happening in such a way that satisfies how the expectations of those that are looking to see things visually. But all of the signs are so incredibly there. The desperation moves are happening more and more each day. And like we said on the show last week, and they made a movie about it, it's called Something's Gotta Give, and it truly does. Something's Gotta Give, and it's gotta give real soon. And, right now it's being made. The signs are just everywhere. You just have to know where to look for them. So, Mindy,
yeah,
thank you for calling
in.
Hang in there. I share your what makes you happiest is seeing other people happy too. So try to do it. Keep doing what you're doing. And at the end of the day, disconnect from it. Get a good night's sleep and go to bed with the total love in your heart that you did everything that you can that was within your control, and the universe will take care of all of the rest.
Another thing, Mindy, to keep in mind.
Yeah.
You just helped, who knows, countless many people just by telling your story. And perhaps this incident happened to allow that story to be told, because now people can really see, and they're revealing themselves for who they are and what they are.
Yeah.
And you relaying this story and helping people to understand what's happening is really making a difference in waking people up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
I've told a lot of people, but yeah, they're getting desperate. I agree. And they tried not to. They said his payment. He went to make his payment the other day, and they said they wouldn't accept his payment. He took cash. They wouldn't accept it, that his payment, that his account was blocked. Well, he went to a different bank, same bank but a different location, and they took the payment there. So he's still up to date.
Yeah, that's that is
it's
just
written in the, it's written in the fine print of the contract. They can foreclose on you whenever they like for whatever reason they like. But most people, who reads the fine print?
Mm-hmm.
It actually
is a disgrace. It's disgraceful behavior. Moments like this, you feel ashamed to be human. Well,
it's
you feel like
business.
You should be. I will never be ashamed to be human, but the behavior of my fellow humans shames me, and we just need to correct that. We've got to correct that behavior.
Well, I'll tell you what, even though I paid off mine, they still wouldn't release my note. I still have not gotten my deed of trust released. And we paid it in full with cash, $10,500 cash. They still have not released it. It's disgusting. This bank is bad, bad, bad. Anyway, I won't keep you guys. I'll let other people get in, but thanks for taking my call.
Thanks for calling in.
You're welcome. Thank you for
calling
in.
Thanks for enduring, Mindy. It's
keep doing
fantastic.
What you guys are doing. I love it.
Yeah, we'll get it over the line. We'll
thank
we'll
you.
Appreciate
the
support. Thanks, Mindy.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Oh, it's disgraceful.
I got a train here. Sorry, I got to mute.
Okay, let's leave this on a high note. We've got
yes, please.
Area code 575.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
I just had something to say, that we need to keep the vision of success within ourselves. Okay, that's all I need to say. And because I forgot what I was going to say previously. You know, and it's just, and I love and appreciate you for talking in a way that I feel. And thank you.
Thank you.
And just keep vision, because we can get involved in all the stuff that is in between. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, too.
Okay, guys, we're about to leave the feed. We've got 30 seconds to go, so
okay.
Beautiful.
Bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Yes, hold the vision. And know it's happening. You know, we are creating this in our each and every now moment. So, what a ride.
Buckle your seatbelts, ladies and gents, because it's coming.
It's coming. It's here.
Yep.
Well, it's been a pleasure. 10 seconds. It's been an absolute pleasure, as always, to spend these couple of hours with you all.
Yeah.
Thanks so much. And bye from me.
Love, light, blessings. Namaste.
Yep.
Good night, everyone.
Passion, endurance. Good night.
And keep an eye on the 5D Media Network Facebook page for all the updates on the shows, on all the shows on the 5D Network. And we'll see you over there. Have the conversations over there. Thank you very much. Bye for now.